So good morning, Paul and Ron. It's 109 days now since LaMelo was gunned down in the middle of I-10 in broad daylight, surrounded by law enforcement. I will tell you that there is some movement. The FBI is investigating as they can ballistics, and of course that's not unusual. I think that there's more than that. I know that there's one organization that is now contemplating or seeking to ask for federal investigation. I was contacted very early on. I can't give a whole lot of details about this, but I was contacted by a person who is in the federal sphere, let's say, who was very adamant about the fact that what happened on that infamous day was not right. It was contrary to everything, every standard that law enforcement will have. You just don't shoot the hostage. You just don't do that. It's particularly when there's other options. Can you inadvertently shoot the hostage while trying to stop a melee, stop it, let's just say the hostage holder, the kidnapper, from inflicting more carnage, killings. There are some situations where you evaluate the many as opposed to the few or the one. This is not one of those. You don't shoot the hostage for the sake of saving yourself when you have the opportunity to get out of the way. Seek cover. Seek cover. And so there are some arguments here. And I won't labor the fact, but I will tell you that there are people in very, very high places who are looking at this, as am I and as are you. And we will not stop until such time we have a reasonable explanation as to what happened to that four-month-old baby. And Velocity. And so, that might be to the chagrin of some, but for others it is, it's noble, as it should be for all of us. And for the individual who feels that, it's just another crack baby that was taken out of the game. Karma is a mother. It really is. Be careful. You know how you evaluate the lives of others. Come back to haunt you. Not wishing anything on you? No, yeah, I am. I'm wishing something on you. How about that? Yeah, I do. Okay? I think you should get what you deserve. Yes. That's what I'm praying for. Whatever that is, whatever justice your maker, your creator seeks that you should have, suggesting that this innocent life was not worthy of living. Yeah, I want you to get what's coming to you. You know, I was always taught that, you know, you can defeat someone with love, but that takes too long. What? You have a problem with that? Am I going too far? Am I just being too honest?
I don't think so. I'm not sure if that's...
Oh, why you have that look on your face and you're putting up those Ten Commandments?
Well, I mean, tablets are here.
Do unto others before they do unto you, I think is how it's written.
I think that's how it goes.
But you will be relieved, those of you, to know that. And by the way, my thanks to John Kemp for actually keeping us posted on a lot of things. John, I left your name out of that group that I mentioned the other day, but I really appreciate it. Your efforts there in Biloxi are noteworthy.
No doubt.
You know, it's time for honorable men. It's time for us to regain that, guys. We have allowed the Trumpicans to just really... Actually, not even Trump, because the conservatives would run this, our entire country, into the hole. I mean, it's to the point whereby these guys have convinced us that being brash, being bold, in your face, is somehow being strong, and it's not. It's not. Being honorable is defending the weak, protecting the innocent. I know that there are those of you who came up along Ronald Reagan, whereby you consider that as goody two-shoes. Dudley do right. Even Ronald Reagan came along when being a Boy Scout meant something more than just being a boy. I don't know how he changed it, except he tried to create some kind of phony baloney machismo that he didn't have because he was an actor. No, he didn't serve in the military. He acted like he did. He even thought he did once he had Alzheimer's.
Bedtime for Bonzo.
He was on 20 Mule Team Bull Rocks, I believe, when I first really started watching him. You don't know what that is. It's It was a cowboy series. I think he was on that. Don't ask me about it. I'm not going to go into it. It's not worthy of that. But I do want to go into this conservative flip-flop. They will flip the script on you in a heartbeat. They'll have you thinking that weak is strong and strong is weak. A tree hugger to them is an offense. Or a woman who simply is trying to fight for her rights in a man's world. Oh, yeah, she's got to be some kind of Nazi. I think someone said Miss Feminazi or something. Are you crazy? They have convinced us that defending the weak and protecting the innocent and fighting for your rights is a bad thing. Every conservative will tell you that. If you want to disagree, call me. I'll give you some examples. The great guru, Maharaja, whatever he is, dead and should be forgotten, Rush Limbaugh. Trust me on that. He's not inclusive. There's nothing inclusive about being a conservative. It's quite the contrary. But they will flip the script on you. They will lead you to believe that that's exactly what it is. I'm against big government. I'm against inclusion. On the other hand, we'll turn around and cite Rip Daniels or Roe or anyone else who is contrary to their beliefs for being, let's see, a militant. Or he just wants critical race theory. That's the new big boogeyman there that no one seems to know about. Or the leftists. Where are these guys? I want to see the guys with the left t-shirts. They've even convinced you that being progressive is a bad thing. In other words, making progress to them is, well, not making America great. Making America great was how it used to be. Of course, when you had the Great Society, of course, that's also when you had Jim Crow, segregated military. But at least you had apple pie and hot dogs in their minds. It's time for honorable men. It's time for those individuals to stand up. I had this conversation yesterday, and I really appreciated it. It's as if somehow or another that person saying, no, you're wrong. No, I disagree with that. I really disagree with that. And take your lumps. Everybody's not going to agree with you. I mean, look, this is what I do. Most of y'all don't agree with me. You're opinionated. Well, who wouldn't be? If you have an opinion, then you're opinionated. So if you disagree, it's okay. You don't have to fall out. You don't have to throw the baby out with the bathwater, for God's sake. There might be some things we can agree on, but we're not going to agree all the time. I have one very special caller here who I attribute coming up with the right description of white and furious. Maybe we disagree. Sometimes we agree. Sometimes I hang up, we move on. Honorable man. Because he's seeking truth, he's seeking right, not right politically right, not right because it makes people like you, but because you're honorable enough to take your lumps. Not everything is going to go the way you want. Let me just tell you, ladies and gentlemen, there is no doubt in my mind And it should be no doubt in your mind that the man that's sitting in the White House is an honorable man. He's not going to do what's politically expedient. Not old Joe. Now, you can sit there and say what you want about him. You can try to come up with the old oxy-conservative criticism. Oh, his cognitive skills. Bro, man's on the one.
Seems like it.
Still has a stutter problem, but he's on the one. Sometimes might forget a few things, but look, has a very good grasp of his faculties and what is going on. Honest. Far more honest than the person we had in the White House. Now, for those of you who support him, that's okay. You can support a liar, a cheat, a thief. You can support that. That's okay, but trust me. Yeah, but you're up to his policies. When you name one of his policies that took this country forward. Now, I mean, hang on. I watched the policies. There are a couple of policies that I think had some merit. But the follow-through of them and his rationale for doing them and the mere fact that he made them not as effective because he made it political. I'll get into that later, the foreign policy and all. He just kept his damn mouth shut. You don't have to tell the world you're doing tariffs. What you've got to do is say, okay, here it is. When you got a guy around the neck, you can stop talking. Because he stopped listening. He just want to breathe. But I was really impressed with old Joe as he made his statement. And we're going to get into this Afghanistan thing, but here is the one statement you need to remember. And he said it very, very well, as it applies to our pulling out of Afghanistan.
Here's what I believe to my core. It is wrong to order American troops to step up when Afghanistan's own armed forces would not. The political leaders of Afghanistan were unable to come together for the good of their people, unable to negotiate for the future of their country when the chips were down. They would never have done so while U.S. troops remained in Afghanistan, bearing the brunt of the fighting for them. And our true strategic competitors, China and Russia, would love nothing more than the United States to continue to funnel billions of dollars and resources and attention into stabilizing Afghanistan indefinitely.
Yeah. That first part. I did not see not one uniform. I mean, I saw all the video. I mean, even on Al Jazeera. I mean, throughout the entire country, I was looking for the 300,000 guys we gave uniforms. I mean, I'm talking really nice uniforms. I'm talking camouflage, even boots. 300,000 boots and uniforms went to these Afghan GIs. I didn't see one, bro, did you?
Fine, still not.
I didn't see anybody with guns. I didn't see a whole bunch of smoke, except coming from the embassy as they were burning everything. I mean, maybe it's because the journalists were not, I mean, it wasn't safe. I mean, I could see that in Kandahar and other places, but you would have thought they would have had, Al Jazeera would have had some film. To show, well, okay, yeah, well, now they're in Kandahar, now they're in this, and now they're in this, in Anbar province. And it was as if they took the uniforms off and then put on the tablecloth.
Well, uniforms cost the American taxpayer $28 million, by the way.
In total?
Mm-hmm.
What about the boots? Man, I like those boots.
Nice.
You can't get those military boots, man.
These are nice uniforms.
Not one, bro! Not one. Where'd all the guns go?
Where'd the guns go? Most importantly, where the guns go?
Not one. You know, I had this strange dream, and I don't dream about crazy things, really. I usually dream about how to fix things, and that's what I was dreaming about with Afghanistan. I said to myself, I didn't see no shooting. No shooting, no, I mean, you really did not see this. It was like, okay, all I saw a bunch of guys in the MC Hammer pants. I don't know how they could think that was cool. That's not cool anymore, is it? I mean, I know that in areas like this, like, you think it's going to be hot, but you want to protect yourself from the sun,
yeah.
So you have yards of fabric around you.
It's coming back in American fashion. It's never gone away in Afghan fashion.
Yeah, I remember Hamid Kazi wearing a cape and all that.
Yeah.
I mean, don't get me wrong, I guess it's the word you wear. And by the way, it's not only there in Afghanistan. I mean, you can find it in Africa as well. Many of you guys have not been there. You have a tendency to think that Africa is just Africa hot all the time, and it is not. It's Africa hot, but it's Africa cold, too. Even in the summertime. I'm talking 40 degrees flying into Cape Town. 40 mile per hour winds. Early morning hours. That's a strange thing. But I mean, it's just, you know, they have these little half hats. You see the little half hats? And I'm not talking about the kind you have at Ingles. They have the little half caps. They got the little bang thing cut out. What did they cut the bib off of a baseball cap? What's that all about? What is that called? Not a koofy. What is that called? And I only see it in Afghanistan. I guess it's some kind of rank, I guess. I don't know. But it's enough to show you a little bang.
The traditional Afghan cap is called a
pakol.
Pakol.
Would you wear one?
Sure would.
You would?
Pretty stylish.
I just don't know. I don't know. It's not too manly.
There's another one called a Peshwari Topi.
Peshwari Topi? Huh. I don't even know what it means something.
For them?
I might be poking fun. I know. If they saw me with this is called a flat cap. If you saw me with this on, they'd probably go, what's with the bill?
Do you sell newspapers?
No, I don't sell any newspapers.
You sell newspapers?
Well, why'd I have to? This a newspaper cap?
It's a newspaper boy cap. Do you sell newspapers?
Well, I just want you to know if that's the kind of cap
you.
Do
you have a bicycle with the newspaper?
I don't have a bicycle,
You don't have a newspaper bicycle?
Well, so you have to wear a cap like that when you have an AK? That's an AK cap?
I know that you have newspapers if you do not have the cap on your head. Where is the newspaper? I want the news.
What is the cap?
I want the news.
I don't know who you are anymore. Where did you get all that garb? You know, I tried to come here. I tried to. Will you stop? You're going to get us in trouble. Don't start that.
Why?
Because, I mean, I guess we want you to know. I mean, you know. I know God is great. There's no doubt. Assalamu alaikum. I know all of that. We're not kidding.
You can't say that.
However, we are pretty much, wouldn't you say we are equal opportunity insulters?
Absolutely.
Maybe no one complains time. when we pretend to be.
We're going to talk about
Christians later. We don't talk about God.
Well.
I want you to listen to just how Joe laid this out. This is presidential. This is honorable. Buck stops here. He's not going to get on and try to, you know, be Mr. Man. You know, pretend that conservative kind of huff and puff, yes, we got them, we knock them out. Do you realize Donald John actually allowed close to 30-some-odd rockets to hit a U.S. military base in Iraq, and he did nothing. And had not the Iraqis shot down their own plane, and he tried to take credit for that. And I mean, and right now, even now, there are guys who are suffering because of brain damage and so forth as a result. I thank God that we've been losing one. I personally think we did, but that's not a here nor there. The man wasn't honorable. So Joe went into this, and he said, look, let me just, I'll just go through all of these, because some of you didn't hear it. You need to hear it. It's not that I just love Joe Biden, by no stretch. But you got to give credit where it's due. It was presidential. It was honorable. You know, he explained very clearly that, okay, well, the double impeached Donald John had cut this deal, was supposed to have been out by May of this year. He pushed it back to August because logistics weren't there.
When I came into office, I inherited a deal that President Trump negotiated with the Taliban. Under his agreement, U.S. forces would be out of Afghanistan by May 1, 2021. Just a little over 3 months after I took office. U.S. forces had already drawn down during the Trump administration from roughly 15,500 American forces to 2,500 troops in country. And the Taliban was at its strongest militarily since 2001. The choice I had to make as your president was either to follow through on that agreement or be prepared to go back to fighting the Taliban in the middle of the spring fighting season. There would have been no ceasefire after May 1. There was no agreement protecting our forces after May 1. There was no status quo of stability without American casualties after May 1. There was only a cold reality of either following through on the agreement to withdraw our forces or escalating the conflict and sending thousands more American troops back into combat in Afghanistan, lurching into the third decade of conflict. I stand squarely behind my decision.
Good for you. You agree with that, Sheriff David? You're not. If you don't, you should. He's right.
Yeah.
He's right. Ladies and gentlemen, we never declared war on Afghanistan. We never declared war on the Taliban. We weren't there to wipe out the Taliban. I don't doubt we could have. There's no doubt. I don't doubt that there's some military personnel who would prefer that. Why don't we just go in and kill them all? Good. I mean, these guys didn't have an Air Force, bro. They didn't have a Navy.
No.
Didn't have a satellite. They wouldn't even wear body armor. You know, for the most part, it's sheep herders by day, you know, fighters by night. But they fight very well. They have the resolve. You know why? They live there. That's why every other major army that's gone in there has not defeated them. Well, why? I tell you why. They live there, and they like it. The rest of us are kind of going, ooh, like this Georgia little place. Too mountainous to walk on. I mean, nothing but a goat but like this. It's just not a whole lot there, bro. I mean, it's not... at the vacation capital of the world. I mean, you think of, well, I wonder what's in Afghanistan. I wonder what's there. I wonder if I can go and go see the mammoth caves.
Mountains and poppies. And maybe giants.
But they love it. It's home for them, and I appreciate that. And so in this dream last night, you know, I thought to myself, okay, here's the strategy. I'm a strategist. I never give up. I never give up. Just as an aside, if you're pursuing business, if you're pursuing anything in your life, you only give up when you stop. Until, if you don't stop, then you've not given up. Won't you understand that? And then you ask yourself, why give up when you can continue? So I never give up. So I thought to myself, if I was there in Kandahar, if I was there in Afghanistan, what would be my secret weapon against the Taliban? It could be, you know, that was a movie called Lion of the Desert. What's his name? Greek. Anthony Quinn played in it. One of my favorite actors of all time. An incredible thespian. I love him when he played, I think, Jimmy the Greek or something like that. He played one of these movies and they were doing the dance. And of course, it was filmed there in the Greek islands. But this was about, he was playing an Arabian terrorist, for lack of a better way. And they were fighting against, I think, either the British or the Australians or someone. Another occupier. And so Anthony Quinn said this, is one of his favorite lines in this. They mate on it during the day, but it's ours in the night. He said that, and it was so, I always remember that as a strategy. And so I thought to myself that maybe that's what's happening here. I didn't see that one uniform, American uniform from these guys, these 300,000. It was 300,000 guys, Joe Biden said, we had that trained. And there was only 30 to 40,000 Taliban, according to them, those hardened warriors. That's 10 to 1. So why didn't I see any uniforms? So I thought to myself, these guys are hiding out. Maybe even hiding under burqas. All of them very, very armed, just letting the Taliban overstretch themselves. And it's hard to run an entire country. So just letting them come out of the hole, that's what you do with rats. You let them come out of the hole first. You'll never defeat them when they're in their holes. There's a poor rat don't have but one hole. You know what I mean? They have different holes, bro.
Yeah. Options.
So, you let them come out. And they let them build some confidence that somehow or another they're running things. Like the insurgents did to our guys there in Fallujah and Iraq. Remember that?
Well.
Let them get comfortable, come out. And then, at night, you kill them. I'm sorry, I couldn't make up anything else. Or, for that matter, what you do is you arm the women with these incredible sabers, and you behead them every night. I thought to myself, there's got to be a strategy here. Because surely the guys who are in uniforms got to know. Well, you know, they were seen in uniform. Did they go out and bring the uniforms? The boots? So I'm thinking to myself, yeah, there's some that they have all kinds of subterranean taverns and so forth, and maybe the 300,000 folks now, instead of liquidating and becoming, because they're still getting paid. You know that, right? They're still getting paid.
By
the United States government.
Okay.
They were on our payroll. And they have been on our payroll the whole time. We've been paying for them to fight for their freedom. Mm-hmm. Really? Really?
Biden spoke to that as well yesterday.
We spent over $1 trillion. We trained and equipped an Afghan military force of some 300,000 strong. Mm-hmm. Incredibly well equipped. A force larger in size than the militaries of many of our NATO allies. We gave them every tool they could need. We paid their salaries, provided for the maintenance of their Air Force. Something the Taliban doesn't have. Taliban does not have an Air Force. We provided close air support. We gave them every chance to determine their own future. What we could not provide them was the will to fight for that future. There's some very brave and capable Afghan special forces units and soldiers. But if Afghanistan is unable to mount any real resistance to the Taliban now, there is no chance that 1 year, 1 more year,
yeah,
5 more years, or 20 more years,
yeah,
the U.S. military boots on the ground would have made any difference.
Amen to that. I'm going to give you the bell. Who disagrees with that? Call me. He's right. You give them all this stuff, you do all this, and you won't fight, and you still want us there? Oh, no. You get off the C-130. What is it, C-17? You know, the folks grabbed hold to the side of the plane, the C-17. Do you know I saw a guy running on the tarmac with Air Force Ones? How about you those, bro? I guess he had them in the right place. They're on the tarmac. I mean, that's why you got to wear those big old shoes. How about the Air Force Ones? That's Kanye's shoes, isn't it?
No. The Air Force is one of the older Nikes.
Well, what was it?
It depends on what you want, but you're looking at about $100 out the door for a low top.
Oh, is it? He was running there in his skirt, and then it was, I don't know what you call it.
It is not a skirt. It is not a skirt, and I am still waiting for my newspaper.
I don't have a damn newspaper.
Well, then this is not a,
do they wear caps like this? The newspaper man wear?
No.
I am not looking at you. Guy running around with a rag around his head.
I want to be informed. I need to be informed.
Alright, so the guy with the Air Force Ones running down the tarmac, did he actually thought that if he had Air Force Ones on the tarmac he'd fly? Is that what that was all about?
I don't think that's what that was about.
Look, I'm not talking fun. Look, listen to me. Listen to me.
This is the
C-17? Yeah, the C-17. Let me just tell you. It's horrible people getting on and then jumping out to planes. But the reality is he would have had a better chance grabbing a gun and fighting the Taliban.
Yeah.
What is your options? Let's see. Let me think about this.
Well, I mean, they packed about 700 in that plane.
You got 15 to 20, 30,000 people on the tarmac trying to get on the planes. And look, I got you. I know they want to leave. Where were the guns? Where are the guys in the military? Their guns were somewhere, bro. I don't see this like Saigon at all. Ladies and gentlemen, I watched Saigon. At the time that it had fallen, I was actually preparing to go to Fort Polk. Be quite certain. Until 1973, nothing even remotely close to this. Nothing even remotely close. That was a lot of carnage, ladies and gentlemen. The Tet Offensive had left 58,000 in total, 58,000 Americans dead in Vietnam. And it was very offensive. It was Ho Chi Minh came down with a vengeance. And guess what? What you found was a lot of those individuals who were being occupied there in South Vietnam, in Saigon, started to turn on the very Americans who were there. You know, your friends weren't again. You realize it was only 2 months ago, bro, that we had a friendly, I guess you can call him that, an action officer, turn on his American Captors? I'm sorry. He's calling us captors. I don't know what it was to you and I, but if you're occupying it, you're there and you're not supposed to be there. I mean, literally shot, what was it, a 3-4? Gee, a service man? What caused it? Well, let's just see. He's in his country and he was insulted and, have a gun.
Simple as that.
So, I'm impressed with Joe. If you're not, you can call me. We can chat about it. I don't have a problem with that. I really don't. But I'm going to show you something. I showed it to you before. I'll show it to you again. Let's see if I can get this out. We're going to reach out to him. You see that right there? At the bottom there, you're going to see that's money actually from Iraq. But this, ladies and gentlemen, is a flag that was sent to me by a dear friend who was there. This flag, that flag right there, was one of the many flags that certifies. This is a certificate. See that right there? That's a certificate. See the little stamp? He just threw in that Iraqi symbol saying money. I don't know if that's going to work anything now. This is a certified that the accompanying American flag was flown by the 3rd Special Forces Group airborne over the Combined Joint Special Operations Task Force Base, Camp Bagram Air Base, Afghanistan, during Operation Enduring Freedom, September the 11th, 2003. In honor of WJZD FM 94.5. And it was signed off on. And this dear friend, ladies and gentlemen, was made it out. And we're going to talk to him, only because we should. He left some of his service members who were there. Well, he didn't leave them there. They lost their lives there. And this will be forever cherished by one Rip Daniels. I don't doubt when you hear from him, he will understand very, very well what Joe Biden was talking about when he said that if they won't fight for it, why should Americans die for it? And when you listen to conservatives come out and talk about the fiasco and it's bad and blah, 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 you need to ask yourself, you want to send your boy over there to die for someone who don't want to fight for their own damn freedom? You think they're worth it? I don't have anything against the Afghans. I have everything for them. It's their country. They will run it the way they should. And they'll have their own little civil wars. I really think it's going to spin out of control. I think all the tribesmen, there's no centralized Taliban force. Right now, the so-called leader is a former judge. At least that's the one that we're saying is a leader. But you realize you very rarely see one person. Every one of those provinces is going to turn into a chaotic situation. I guarantee you that. And that is the way they want it. By the way, for those of you who are thinking that they're just too over and extreme, the Sharia law, one of our greatest allies still has Sharia law. It's called Saudi Arabia. Ladies are still in burqa. I thought you should know. Oh, they let them drive. Notice I said let them.
Yeah, let.
With permission. All right, quick break. It's going to be a full and fun day. And yes, prepare to be informed, whether you like it or not. We'll be back.
Hello, Mississippi. This is Dr. Gary Jones.